For the last weeks, I've been testing 3ds Max 2024. Let me share with you what I've discovered. This video is sponsored by Autodesk. I was granted early access to the new 3ds Max update, so I can play around with the new features and present them to you as quickly as possible. For sure you're interested, so let's dive in. Firstly, I want to show you my favorite feature, as I think it's a game changer for modeling. Boolean in the form of modifier. As you know, before we could use a boolean as a compound object, but now we can also use it as a modifier, and I definitely recommend doing so. We can find numbers operands, the same as in the boolean compound object. However, we have one extra called split, which I will show you later. Here is the place where all the operands objects are listed, so here the true magic happens. So let's choose subtract as an example. Now, we only have to click the object we want to cut out. Done! Okay, a lot of going on here, but first things first. The object is perfectly clean, no weird edges. Also, no weird vertices as we used to have in the boolean compound object. What a relief, isn't it? We can attach an object. You can see it is automatically added to the list. You also can notice that the workflow is smooth and easy. We just need to click the operation we want to do and click a relevant object. Another awesome feature that makes life easier is the fact that the main object takes the materials from the object we use to subtract, add, and so on. Here, you can see it clearly. All the relevant polys are red now. It is a big time saver, especially if we have complicated models. No need to spend time selecting polys manually and adding the material to them. And the most magical thing of all, we can edit the boolean and go back to the previous versions of the object. So we can, for example, turn off the object. Or we can change the type. I don't want this to be subtract anymore. No problem, just change it to whatever you like. It's awesome, isn't it? Can you imagine how this speeds up modeling? No need to remodel, more room for mistakes without consequences. I'm impressed. We can also move the objects on the list. As you can guess, the order is very important here. You can notice that we get different results. It's all straightforward though. When we have the object selected on the list, we can modify it and it will affect the boolean. Don't you believe me? I will show you then. I can, for example, change its parameters. But also, you can adjust modifiers if there are any. As you can see, when I click on the object, it is selected in the Modify panel. Anyway, we can also move, scale, and rotate objects. Plus, we can copy them with the Shift key. Let's say I wanna cut out a hole in here. No problem, just copy the cylinder. We can extract the original operand or as a copy. We can add a specific material if we want. And we can subtract, for instance. The next thing to talk about is manipulate operands option. It will allow us to quickly make changes to operands without need to look for them in the list. You can see that each operand is represented by a sphere. We can just click on them and make changes. We can move, scale, or rotate. We can right-click on the sphere and we'll get the list of options. It's pretty handy to have these options here to quickly make changes. I really like it. Now let me show you what split is all about. I copied the red box. Now I will use the split option. You can see that it created the outline in the place where the objects are joined. It looks inconspicuous, but when you add an edit poly modifier to it, you'll see the true beauty of this. By the way, we have now a search box for modifiers. Not a big change, but pretty handy. You can see that this is a different element now. It's great, isn't it? Another handy option is the possibility to make variations of the object. Let's say that I want a copy without the text. I can turn off the object and use the Create Objects option. As I had the Hide Boolean option on, I need to unhide it now to see it back. And now, I have two variations of the object, one with and one without the text. Cool! We have two additional features in the Mesh Options tab. Imprint inserts intersection edges between the operands and the base object. It can be helpful when we want to make some quick adjustments. For example, we can add the Editable Poly modifier and extrude this poly with Shift. While Cookies performs the selected boolean operation without adding faces from the operands to the original mesh. So it basically makes a hole. Except for that, we have display options that we can adjust to our needs. We can choose what we want to see and how we want to see this. And lastly, we can change the method from mesh to OpenVDB, a widely used format for storing volumetric data. We can also change the voxel size if we wish. Anyway, I need to say that I'm really impressed by the Boolean Modifier. It will be so helpful during modeling. Great job, Autodesk. There are some updates in Array Modifier. The most important is an option to generate spiral-based distribution patterns. Similar to ones you can see in nature, they are based on the Gaussian ratio, so different sorts of plants, flowers, shells, and so on. We can quickly create various models. As an example, I will create a succulent. We can use the Array Modifier. We need to choose the new distribution type from the list, phyllotaxis. We have many parameters we can adjust here. We can change the number of objects in the array, for example. We can also adjust start and end radius. Radical bias moves the clones progressively toward the end radius or the start radius position. The angle basically controls how twisted the array is. Axial controls the effect in Z axis. The other two options make progressive changes to the array. We can also choose different variations by changing the face. This way we can create various options for the same model. Anyway, now I can adjust strength to make it more condensed. I will reset the end radius to 0. So this will be more or less it. We can of course add some randomization to it, but it is nothing new. However, in local rotation and scale, we have a new option, progressive. It basically lets you alter transfer data so we can progressively change from the first to the last mesh distribution. It is a pretty cool option as it may be helpful in lots of cases, especially when we model things from nature. An additional option in phyllotaxis is distribution spline. You can just pick a spline that will be used as a path for the clones. Let me move some vertices so we can see the changes. So by moving the points, we influence the distribution of the cloned objects. We can assign the material IDs using new methods. Random is pretty self-explanatory. Ordered can be handy. Let me show you what it is about. So I will apply the multi-sub material with 5 colors of the leaves, just to demonstrate the changes there. Let's change this value to 5. You can notice that the colors are added in order. First, we have leaves with ID 1, which is green, then 2, which is violet, and so on. So the IDs are applied in order. We have also first, middle, last, where we basically set the ID for the first and last object, and everything in between is randomly distributed based on the IDs you will choose. There are also some improvements in Editable Poly and Edit Poly Modifier. On the left-hand side, I have 3ds Max 2023, while on the right-hand side, 3ds Max 2024. You can easily notice that there is a difference in how the objects look. The one from new Max looks smoother. You will see it even better when I add the cap option to both of them. You can notice that the faces that are generated are now applied to the same smoothing groups, so you can create smooth results. When in 3ds Max 2023, we had these triangular faces visible. Also, they bring improvements to the retriangulation of polygon face data, like face splitting by intersection of edges, slice, cut, bridging, vertex extrusion, and edge extrusion. And there is automatic retriangulating of polygon faces when a vertex, edge, or face component has been adjusted to cause edges and hidden faces to cross. One of the big changes in 3ds Max 2024 is that color management has been added. Now we have complete control over our colors. We can manage it from preference settings. You can see that we have a new tab dedicated to this here. By default, it is set up to Gamma Workflow, which is a legacy mode. But we can also choose OCIO, which is a technology preview, so it has some limitations. The preferences are set at global level, but if you click Show Advanced Settings, you will be able to override specific parts, for example, the viewport. You should get the pop-up with this information and also the link to the forum so we can send the team feedback on this. They also let us load our own files if we wish. Then we need to choose another option. They also color managed the render frame buffer. After you render a frame, you will be presented with the drop-down list box for display and view transform. Plus, there are two sliders for diagnostic purposes, for exposure and gamma. The viewport is also color managed. You can see the new option in viewport preferences. So we can change it here. You can notice that it can be changed per view, so we can have different results in each viewport. There is also a change in color picker. So now we can see scene and display color. And also, when loading the bitmap, you can choose automatic color space, or you can choose the one from the drop-down list box. By the way, Arnold Render View also supports color management. Now, the Slate Matter Editor is made with Qt, which introduces the docking capability. You can dock it just like any toolbar, just drag it over wherever you like and release the mouse button. Let me turn off this toolbar. I really like that, it will be really useful. I think I will be using this setup most often with a material editor on one side and one viewport on another side. You can undock it just as easily. Of course, you can dock it to other places as well. I will turn off the ribbon too. This setup would be better if you need to have two viewports visible at the same time. Another update to the Slate Material Editor relates to wires. Now, wires by default are drawn behind the nodes. You can change that in preferences by unchecking this box if you for some reason prefer to have them in front. Here is how it looked in the previous version. I prefer the newer look as it's way cleaner and more organized. Now we can also customize colors in the Slate Material Editor. We can do so in the Customize User Interface in the Colors tab. We need to find the SME category. Here we can change all the individual elements. Let's make the grid red. To see the changes, we have to click this button. Here it is. I will change the background to green as well. We can reset it to default here. We can change other elements as well, like wires, for example. There are different colors for different types of wires. I think I will stick to the default colors though. The option I'm gonna show you now is another one that I value the most. Compound nodes are definitely super helpful during the production process. Here is the sand material from my advanced visualization course. As you see, it's quite complicated. Now we can group some maps and materials together inside compound nodes. To do that, select the nodes, right-click and choose the option Package Nodes in Compound. I will do it with other maps as well. As you can see, it looks way cleaner now. To edit the compound, just double-click on it and you will be inside. These violet nodes are input and outputs. If you click exit, you will get back to the main view. You can also create nested compounds, so the compounds that are inside other compounds. Just go inside the compound and do it the same way I described before. We can go inside. Here, you can see we are in the second compound. We can go back like that. We can also add materials to compounds. In this case, we don't have any input and output because we selected the whole thing. We can add it though. Go inside, draw the wire out, and click Expose as output parameter. Here it is. The same for input. Another great thing about compound nodes is that we can add them to the library. Just right-click, choose the Add to Material Library option, and choose your library. Here it is. Now we can reuse it or share it with other users. Great feature, isn't it? There is one more update to materials, the new material switcher. It's a great tool for people who work with different design variations. Here, I have a chair model with a multi-sub material. Let's say a client is not sure about this color and I need to render a couple of different versions. Let me move it away. I will create the material switcher. Here, we can set how many variations we want. Next, I will replace the pink material with the material switcher and plug it into the first slot. I will create other variations as well and plug them into the other slots. Now we can just click the icon and the material is switched. Cool, right? We can lock the material here, so we don't change it by accident. The material switcher also works with multi-sub materials. Here I have three variations for the chair materials. I can add a material switcher and plug all of them in there. I have to apply the switcher material to the chair. Now we can easily switch between materials here. Next, let me present some new animation features. Here I have a simple animated camera in my scene. Let's start with a transfer list controller. And what it does is it lets you stack multiple transform controllers on your objects. To add it, we have to click on the base transform position here on the top, then click this icon and add a transform list. We can see this new window here. Now we can assign another controller. It works kind of like layers. It can be very useful, for example, if you want to build animation on top of the other animation and don't want to destroy your keyframes. I will use it to introduce some camera shaking. I will select the position and change the type to the noise controller. I will decrease values so it's not crazy shaky. Pretty easy, right? And original keyframes stay untouched. We can control the width of each transform list, which is kind of like the strength of the effect. If I lower it, it becomes less noisy. The opposite is also true. A really cool thing is that we can animate the width. So we can make it not shaky at the beginning, then increase the effect. And at the end, decrease it back. Here is how this looks. There is also an index option. What it does is it lets you switch between different controllers. So right now, only the first controller with original animation works. If we switch to two, we have only the shake animation. It can be really helpful if you, for example, have a few different variations of the same animation in a scene and you want to quickly switch between them. Motion paths now support a larger set of position controllers, enabling us to have a wider range of support to manipulate animation data directly in the viewport. Here we can nicely see the noise controller on top of the camera animation. There is a couple of more smaller updates. For example, when you apply the symmetry modifier, it will now operate on the x-axis by default instead of z-axis. Or improvements to weld operations of spline objects or a faster STL import. I need to say that I'm impressed by some new features of 3ds Max. Especially Boolean and compound nodes are game changers for me. These options will make life so much easier and the workflow much more productive. Let me know what you think and what is your favorite feature. Bye bye!